Good morning. I guess we're a little behind, but I'll go ahead and start. My name is Brian Kelmar. I'm the Executive Director of Legal Reform for Intellectually and Developmentally Disabled. It's not working.
Just go ahead and talk because for the camera.
Okay. There you go. Anyway, I'm also the co-founder of this organization. And just real quick, a show of hands if people have a family member with autism. Okay. So this happens a lot, of them getting caught up in the criminal justice system. That's why I started. So I'm going to tell you a little bit, first my story. My son is autistic, and he was 19 years old when this happened. And it was his first time off to college. And he met a young lady at my younger son's bar mitzvah party earlier in the year. And as an autistic, they don't have any friends, right? And they don't know how to interact. So this girl started texting him while he's away at college. There's no supports. He was up there for summer just to get just an initial, you know, check-in and get used to the college. And he was in the autism program at Marshall University. Except they didn't start the autism program until the fall. So there was no supports there at the time. So this young lady texts him out of the blue, says hi. And we found out she liked him or something, and actually they were dancing together at my son's bar mitzvah, and my wife went, excuse me, young lady, can you please sit down and leave him alone, because my son had no idea. She was dancing a little, whatever, but I'm not going to go into that. Anyway, she starts texting him. The text starts, very nice, what's your favorite color, what's your favorite football team, blah, 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 and he thinks he has a friend. Right? As it goes along, she starts getting very sexually aggressive. Can we be friends with benefits? Can we do these different things? I'm laying here naked, etc. And she says, you really don't know what I'm talking about, do you? And he went, no. And he tries to get rid of her because he's not sure what's going on. He's never been with a girl, right? So he's never... And they hadn't had the proper sexual health education, so he has no idea what this is. So he tries to tell her, I've got a girlfriend, and she leave me alone. 12 hours later, she starts back up again, and they start getting more sexually and sexually aggressive. Anyway, she wants to meet him. She wants to hook up. Now, he has no idea what hook up means. So he thinks, if I meet with her, she'll leave me alone. So when he comes home, he picks her up, and he hooks up with her, or meets with her. He's driving around, and he stops at an abandoned lot. He has occult spina bifida, so he has a hard time sitting and can't sit for a long time, so he has to pull over. She starts getting very aggressive. He's not sure what to do. So what is it with autism, right? You have sensory issues, you have lights, you have smells, you have touch, you have all these different sensory overloads, and I explain to people, it's like a computer that you have all the, like this computer, right? All the programs are up, and they are going all at once, and what happens? It freezes. She starts getting aggressive, takes off her top, pulls down his pants, starts getting stuff, he freezes. 2 minutes later, in the middle of an act, right, he says, stop. She was doing oral type things. He says, stop, because his computer rebooted and realized this is wrong. Takes her home, that's it, right? Middle of the night, 3 o'clock in the morning, police come knocking at the door. His room is right above the entrance door. I was sleeping. He answers the door. They take him outside. They start asking him questions. Now, he feels, which is, you can judge, that she did something inappropriate. She attacked him. So the police officer says, do you know this girl? And he says, yes. And he says, can you tell me what happened? Yes. She started to do this and this and this, thinking that she was in trouble for attacking him. I come downstairs, I find out what's going on. I said, whoa, 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 whoa. I said, he has autism. He doesn't have a clue to what you're talking about, even understanding the situation. They said, that's all right, it doesn't matter. He's already confessed, and they didn't read him his rights, right? They trick him into saying, do you know what happened, right? And said, we just want to talk to you. Anyway, they took him off to jail. I finally got him out of jail. When I got him out of jail, it was 2 days. He reverted to like a little child. He sat on my lap and goes, Daddy, what do I do? He was in tears. He was a wreck. They go to proceed to charge him with rape. Well, we said, really? So what happened? So the little girl said, well, she lied to her parents and said that she was hanging out with her friends and that she didn't go. Then she said, the police said, have you ever texted? She goes, no, not at all. Really? My older son was smart enough to take pictures of every single text message, 265 text messages. And they're very, very graphic. All of us would be blushing if I read them to you. So we show it to him and said, what do you mean she said she never texted him and she never sexted him? Bam. Here's all the 265 copies. So me not knowing, I've never been in a legal system just like any of the rest of you. I'm just a dad. And we hire a lawyer that we knew. He's done traffic stuff, and he said he's done a few sex crimes. Okay, and we think, this is ridiculous. You do know that this kid has autism, and he doesn't have a clue what's going on either here or in the criminal justice system. No, no, they were going for blood. They were going to put him away for 20 years. So they finally, and the lawyer was kind of, you know, like a lot of people with lawyers, is that they don't talk to you like until 15 minutes prior to the trial. They'll literally take you in the room prior. And he says, we have to plead guilty. And my son's an Eagle Scout. He goes, Dad, I can't lie. I'm not guilty. He goes, well, you have to plead. So he said, can we plead no contest? So we did. In the state of Virginia, you can't bring in their autism until the sentencing phase. So he had to plead guilty. Then we went to the sentencing phase, and we had all of these experts testify that he didn't have a clue. Even the forensic psychologist who was on the prosecutor's side, he said, this kid didn't have a clue, and she was the sexual aggressor. But because he was 19 and she was 13, he was the one that was charged. So he was charged, and the judge said, okay, I get it. It was a two-hour sentencing. And the judge said, clearly this kid has some type of disability, mental disability. But unfortunately, the courts don't recognize that. So he sentenced him to 5 years for two counts of consensual sex. And he said, but clearly I understand the situation. So he's full on probation. And he said, your probation, go back to college, you're done, never want to see you again. Well, great. All right, maybe I could handle that while he's on probation. But now he has two counts of felony. Then the police show up 6 days later, and they said, hey, we're with the state police. We have to register him. I was like, okay. And I didn't realize that it was going to be, I thought it was going to be for the time that we sentenced. No, because of the age difference in Virginia, he's on the violent sexual predator list for life. I went to go to appeal this, because you have 45 days. And I told the lawyer, I said, stop, I want to go back. I said, okay, I'll take care of it. And I called him that day. I said, did you file? He goes, no. I go, what do you mean you didn't file? Because they didn't file, we didn't want to bring it back. I was livid. So we are living with this. I went to go file again. My attorney, which I didn't realize at the time, was mentally insane. Literally. He ended up committing suicide 6 months later. He was really having a mental breakdown and had no idea. Now, he did a pretty good job, but still, he had these mental issues. We appealed it. We went all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court, and at the time, it was gay marriage, and there was a bunch of other stuff that was pretty heavy in the Supreme Court. And in the Supreme Court, they only take about 70, 80 cases out of 10,000 that are submitted. So his was not taken. So what happened? I said, first of all, I couldn't believe this happened. How can you not take into account his autism and understanding the situation until the sentencing phase and that you have to plead guilty? This is unreal. So I said, I'm gonna talk to everybody I did. And I reached out to the ARC of the U.S. and I spoke to them, and they said, it has to do with sex. We can't really do anything. Right? Because that was the staff, the president and all the board members saying that. But the people who heard me, they went, oh my God. And just like you guys went, oh my God, I can't believe this happened. They said, Brian, what we want you to do, we want you to do a webinar that we do on sexual health and this type of thing in the criminal justice system. And it's Leanne Davis, and she's with the National ARC, National NJDD, I forget what that stands for. But anyway, so we spoke, and they typically have about 100 to 150 people that sign up to these things every month. There were over 1,000 people signed up for this, and the net crashed. It couldn't take anymore. And they had hundreds waiting to get on to the presentation. So here I am as a parent, right? I'm the only one in the world that's ever gone through this. Oh my God, I can't believe this happened. No, it's pretty common. So we decided to form a group, and it was a subcommittee of the ARC. And there was three of us. I'm the co-founder, Carol Neskis, and one or two others. We were just a subcommittee, and people started hearing our story, and I started getting phone calls or emails. In fact, the ARC would say, we got this email, and they refer it to me. In fact, even when you go to the ARC now, and you say, I have a child with autism, and he got caught up in the criminal justice system, they go, Brian. So if you ever have done that, it goes to Brian. It's me. But now we have a website. So anyway, we formed this, they got it back up. So we formed this organization called LRIDD. Where's the arrow keys? Oh, okay. All right. So we said, this is ridiculous. There has to be a change. People got to realize these kids are kids in there. So I started the organization. That was about 6 years ago. I talked about this. We're in every single state. We are in conjunction with Canada and the UK, so technically we're international. I talked to at least probably anywhere between probably about 8 people a week in my spare time. This is my full-time job. I think we've spoken to, and I think yes. So actually, everyone who contacts me, all several thousands, I've spoke to personally. Okay, so I've heard all the cases, and most of them I'll tell them, okay, stop. I already know your story. Just tell me where you're at. I said he's autistic, he was a good kid, he never got in trouble, he's naive, he never had any peers, he never understood sexual health, he doesn't understand what's going on. They went, yeah, how did you know? That's exactly what's happening with autistics. So most of our families that are in our group, I would say 95% of them, or 98% are autistics. We do have some with Klinefelter's, a couple other things, traumatic brain injuries, and ID, intellectual and developmental disabilities. So, but 95% of our cases involve sex. It's either they're caught in the stings, right? Downloaded child porn or inappropriate behavior. Those are the three things. So one of the things I found is I looked into the courts and I said, you take into account mental illness, you take into account alcoholism, you take into account drugs, but there's nothing in the law that says anything about developmental disabilities. And you'll hear this over and over and over. Even in the president will say, oh yeah, we're going after mental health, and if you're here in Virginia, yeah, we're going after mental health. And I go, look it up in the dictionary. Mental health is not developmental disabilities. Mental health is mental illness. And here's the difference. Mental illness can onset at any age. You can treat it or cure it. Developmental disabilities, you're born with this. You're not going to cure it. Nobody has gotten the Nobel Medical Prize for autism yet. Now, I haven't heard about that. Maybe it was announced last week, but nobody has gotten that, right? So they're two completely different things. I tell people it's like you're going to see a heart doctor for your heart, and you see a foot doctor for your foot. And I don't want the foot doctor working on my heart, and I don't want the heart doctor working on my foot. It's the same thing. They're completely different. Here's the different types of developmental disabilities. As you know, most of them, it's 1 in 44 now, autism. And I work, my day job is at Commonwealth Autism. It's probably actually higher than that, because, and I think I spoke to a couple parents, most of these kids aren't diagnosed. It's over 50% are not diagnosed until after the age 5. And that doesn't mean at age 6 that they're diagnosed. It's like my son, he wasn't diagnosed until he was 16. And many of them don't get diagnosed until they get into the criminal justice system. This is an important one, because this is what's going on with an autistic or a person with a developmental disability. Their physical growth, the chronological age, right, 1, 2, 3, 4. Their sexual growth, what's going on with them, you know, puberty or whatever the things of any other teenager as they go. They're a little behind. They're usually a little bit behind in school, probably about 2 to 3 years. But look at this bottom line. This is the social development. This is the sexual understanding and understanding social cue and what's going on. Look how far that is. And I tell parents, it's usually half their age or less. So if your son's 20 and he's getting caught up in the criminal justice system, his sexual understanding in that, in this situation, is that of a 10-year-old. And that was actually the situation with my son. He was actually that of a 10 or 11-year-old. She was the 13-year-old. So technically, she was the one that was older. But they don't take into account the developmental age. They only take into account chronological age. Bunch of facts about children with autism. Let's see. The middle line is probably the most important one. Most of the autistics do not get sexual health education. Because what happens when they go into school? You have autism. We have other classes. You're not going to get it anyway. In Virginia, it's also optional. So they don't even get regular sexual education, even if they want to. In a lot of counties in Virginia, there's no sexual health education. Well, for them, it's very black and white. And if they don't, nobody explained to them in black, they do not have the social capability to pick up innuendos and what peers and how many here, I had one lady do a presentation. She said, how many here learned about sex from their, in school? I was like, how many of you learned from your preacher? One or two hands. How many of you learned from your mom or dad? Two or three hands. How many of you learned from your peers? Everybody's hand goes up, right? That's where you really learned about sex. They don't have any peers. They don't have any interactions with others because they're isolated. The other thing is, there's a statistic that people with developmental disabilities are 7 times more likely to get caught up in the criminal justice system than any of the rest of the population. But they're no more criminalized than anybody else. And it's because of their autism. So I looked at this and I said, these laws were created for one size fits all. Everybody gets thrown under the bus no matter what. And I said, that's wrong. You have to take into account their disabilities. It's destroying the families. The autistic, I mean, I have a lot of parents, the autistic goes, oh, good, I get to see Bobby. Bobby's the police officer, comes over. Good, I get to talk to Bobby, right? Can I see his gun? It's like, and it's the parents that are really dealing with this. It's not the kid because they don't have the capacity to understand. And it's really discrimination against autism. Challenges. We've talked a little bit about this, about why they offend. They don't understand the social, the environmental, or the legal consequences. They don't have a clue. Most kids don't have a clue, right? An autistic 10 times worse doesn't have a clue because it wasn't black and white. Because their brain is wired differently than the rest of ours, and the way they have to take information that we can pick up through social cues, social norms, and social taboos, they don't pick that up. So they have to have it explained very explicitly. And if you have an autistic child, you know that you have to actually put them on a schedule. They're very rigid. Because the way their brain is worked, it's going on overdrive on sensory issues, and they can't take in what's going on around them. So what happens? They engage in risk or offending behaviors. One, and there's a statistic, autistics. I'm going to talk autistics, although it applies to all the individual and developmental disabilities as well. Autistics will get in trouble. Either one, they'll get sexually abused, because why? The neurotypical person will say, this is what you do. This is okay. You're supposed to do this. And they go, well, I want to fit in. I don't know what I'm supposed to do, so I guess I do that, right? So they get sexually abused. Two, on the other end, they don't know what's appropriate or inappropriate behavior. There's a lady here, Rachel, she's running around, she's on her LRIDD. Her son went and hugged somebody in the hallway. They tried to charge him with sexual assault and trying to hump the girl. He has no idea what that means. But they charged him in there. We were able to get him off. So what happens? They get in risky behavior. And how other ways do they do it? Well, where do they learn about sex? Where do you learn about anything today? You Google it, right? So they're going to Google it, and they're going to get onto a website, and this website is going to go down into the nth degree. Now, they're not going to be able to tell whether this girl is 18 or 14 because they only really look at the eyes, and they don't understand the parts of the body, really, of whether that's developed. And is that a 30-year-old that's very thin? Maybe. I don't know. They can't differentiate. The other thing is what they'll do is they get focused on something. And what will they do? Click, 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 click. I had one that was downloaded a million images. And I was on the stand, and the prosecutor said that. And he caught me off guard because the defense lawyer didn't tell me that. And I went back and I thought about that. I said, a million images. And I did the little math there and I said, 10 seconds an image, a million images. That would take you 10 years to look at. Do you really think he looked at all million images? Or do you think maybe just like the autism thing, he just clicked? And that's what it was. So it's called counterfeit deviance. It appears like deviant behavior, but it's not. It's just because of their autism and they don't understand what is right and what is wrong because they've never been taught that. They need to have been taught that. It's a disconnect in the brain. They really do not have the capacity to understand. One of the persons on our board is a doctorate and he actually wrote a book on this, Nick Dubin. And they said, well, you're a PhD, you're a writer. There's that part of that brain that does not work. As Nick says, as he tells me, he says, I know how to drive a car, but I don't know how to parallel park, right? Same thing. The rest of the brain works fine, but that one part does not work, and he doesn't understand it. So what have we done? We've replaced, you used to remember when they used to have the mental institutes, and if you had autism, they put them away and just basically throw them away. And they said, well, no, that's bad, and we got away, which is good. But what have they done? They didn't put any things in between. And now they've replaced that with jails. Let's see. Go ahead.
When I was in prison, I was trying to advance the child, and he actually was in a orphanage. And later on, it was the same building, the prison that we were both at.
Yeah. And we have a lot of those cases. The other thing that we brought up is this thing called lack of mental capacity. And if you're a lawyer, and I've learned this term, it's called mens rea. Mens rea means, did they have the criminal intent to really do that? And the answer is no. They had no clue that it was criminal or wrong or that it was socially not correct. And we'll talk a little bit more of that. And do they have the capacity to understand the criminal justice system? The answer is no. But the test is very low. Do you know what a court is? Do you know what a judge is? Do you know what a lawyer is? Well, my son happens to watch, Law and Order? Favorites, so he knows exactly what that. Did he have a clue of what he was doing and what he was saying? In fact, when he had to plead guilty, and it's in the transcript, they said, do you understand what you're agreeing to? Say yes, Blynn, yes. Do you understand the charges? Yes. He had to look to the lawyer for every question. He had no clue. He didn't understand the criminal justice. He was not able to, give enough support to help defend himself. It's actually morally wrong what they're doing. Because we talked about the taboos. They don't understand what's private and public behavior. A lot of the young autistics, they don't know, right? They'll even start out in kindergarten, they'll go outside, and they'll pee in the playground. That's wrong. I didn't know that. Right? Because they don't understand that, and that has to be trained and educated on that. They don't pick up visual cues. If you're saying no, or if this is inappropriate, or even looking at the child porn, they don't pick up any, whether it's appropriate or not. It's not registering. And as we always say, they look people in the eyes. They don't really look at anything else because they're trying to focus. So autistics will typically have to look in, either look into your eyes or look away. They can't do both. Why? And I asked my son that. He said, well, if I look in your eyes, then I can't understand what you're saying. I can't do both at the same time. And this is what happens. And we talked about, hidden cues. When they arrest them, or they arrest any of them, they ask them, okay, do you know this? Do you know that? And they'll go yes. Why? Because they're trying to hide their autism, typically. And then when you start digging down, and you start digging, and you go, all right, so explain that to me. They can't explain it. They said yes because that's what they thought you wanted to hear, especially in a police officer. You're the authority. I'm going to say whatever you want. If you want me to tell you that I killed Abraham Lincoln, I will say yes. Blake, you weren't born. Your grandparents weren't even born. Well, you're the police officer, so, and that's what you want. I want to please you, so I'm going to say yes. And they will do that. And they get, basically, you have law enforcement. You know, we talked about some of the things over here about the illegal things. You have law enforcement basically are professionals and trained on this, and you have a child. And you're interrogating a child, and you're tricking them. There's the famous, New York Park Five, where they charged all those kids. One of them was autistic. And they went, okay, well, if you sign this piece of paper, we'll let you go. And they went back and they took it to the prosecutor and go, no, it can't say that. It has to say this and this. So they crossed it out and they wrote this stuff and go, okay, now you have to sign this. So he said, okay, I'll sign it. Right? And he didn't do a thing. So we talk about this, and I fought some laws on this, recidivism. How often do they go back to doing this? First of all, they're very rule-bound. Very rule-bound. Once they're taught, they will not deviate an inch. In fact, they'll go to the extreme. They'll say, you're looking at this man funny. That's wrong. And they go, calm down. I'm just looking at him because I'm speaking to him, right? So what happens is, if you train them, they will actually learn that. And they will never, ever, ever repeat that, ever. So we did a study. We have a lawyer that's studying this. And he's followed over 100 people that got caught up on the criminal justice regarding sex that have had the sexual health education. We'll talk about that. The recidivism, zero. So, you know, when you go on, even with the sexual crimes, they go, it's, 4% or something recidivism. But they exaggerate it. For autistics, it's zero. So where's the threat? Where's the issue? And as I mentioned before, they're more likely to be victims than they are aggressors, similar to my son. A lot of information, and I guess we'll have these slides available, but I wanted to put that in there. It's really impacting families, okay? Most of these people rely on their families for life, for their executive functioning. My son has somebody helps him do the groceries and helps him, you know, go make cooking and clean his house and keeps his bills. They rely on the families for executive function. Well, if you have an autistic child, living that is very challenging, making it through the day, let alone having a felony, let alone having the sexual registry. They do not understand the compliance of the sexual registry. I call the state police officer every time my son has to register. And said, okay, you know, he's coming, and he knows now what to do. But without me, he would have been arrested. And there's a case where he almost got arrested. I'll talk about that real quick because it's an interesting story. My son was going to Marshall University, has an autism program. It's in Huntington, West Virginia. We live in Virginia. So every time Blake would leave the state to go to college, He'd have to unregister in Virginia. He'd have to go to the state police within 2 days when he got to West Virginia and register. Then when he came home for Thanksgiving, he'd have to unregister, come back and re-register, and then at the end of the week, unregister, and then go back and re-register. Well, the police officer that we work with was out on vacation, and the other individual was filling it out, and Blake said, yeah, okay, but he didn't read the fine print. The guy checked the wrong block. Police officer called us and said, Mr. Kelmar, I think we're going to have to issue a warrant for your son's arrest. I said, what for? Well, he's said he's a resident here in Virginia, but he's in West Virginia. I go, what are you talking about? I've been there. He said, no, I think they checked the wrong block. Oh, okay. He goes, no, it doesn't matter if we made this mistake or not. They're going to issue a warrant. So I said, and I had a very good relationship with the state police officer. I said, so let me see if I get this straight. You want me to drive up to Huntington, West Virginia, which is 6 hours away, go and get him unregistered, which they're not open until the morning, then drive back 6 hours, get him registered into Virginia, then turn right back around, unregister in Virginia, and take him back to West Virginia and get him re-registered. And oh, by the way, it's finals week. I went, oh, I'll lose the paperwork for a couple of weeks. Thank you. But had I not had that relationship, Blake would be in jail right now. For 5 years. It would have put him away for 5 years. So these are the things. This is what's happening. We talk about isolation, right? They're already isolated as is. They're further isolated with this. They don't get a lot of the supports like Section 8 housing because they can't get a job. 95% of the kids, 85% of autisms cannot get a job. If you have a criminal record, it's probably 95% to 99%, and the only reason you got a job is because you knew somebody. It was a friend. They can't get social services. So if people are meeting for autism and they have support groups in a church and there's a daycare center, nope. If you want to go to synagogue or church and there's a daycare center, nope. So you're basically isolating. And what you're doing is, 5 minutes, okay. I'm going to jump ahead on that because I want to show you what we did. So I was pissed. So I went to the legislation, and I just spoke to my state legislation. She was presenting at a town hall, and I said, let me tell you my story. And the ARC helped me to say, Brian, tell your story, and I did. And she goes, oh, my God. And I said, well, what do we have to do? I said, well, the first thing we have to do is prevention. We have to make sure that those that have autism get that sexual health education as early as possible. Because number one, if they're attacked, they're going to know that it was wrong and they'll report it. Number two, they're going to learn inappropriate behaviors. So I wrote this bill and I reached out to this lady who helped me and I wrote this whole curriculum and I said, here. And they went, okay. And they put it in. I was like, oh my God, I'm a parent. I have no idea what I'm doing. I just wrote a law. Luckily, it didn't pass. They came back and they said, well, we think we should do it like this. I went, okay. In fact, the Secretary of Education called me up and said, Brian, can we meet with you? It's like, yeah. I said, well, here's what we're thinking. Are you okay? Me? I said, yes, I'm okay. She goes, okay, that's what we'll do. So they did exactly what I did. They put it in, and it actually started going through. And it's like, oh, my God, this is going to be a law. And it passed unanimously on both the House and Senate. It became a law. So that was the first one, was prevention. The next one that we push is SB was diversion at the same time. So in my son's case, why couldn't you take him out in the sentencing phase and do diversion, which means basically we're going to get you the education. You come back in 2 years and we're going to throw the thing out. Judges have always been allowed to do that, but it was never codified in the law. So I actually, when we testified in one of the cases, the judge goes, yeah, we've always talked about this academically, but we didn't know if we could really do it. But this law says you can. So that was a big step forward. And the last one we did in that same year was HB 659. If you're in the prison system, you have to take into account their autism. Guess what? They screen for mental illness. They screen for alcoholism. They don't screen for developmental disabilities, which is most of the people that are in the prison are autistic, and they don't realize it. Yes, sir?
Just to validate your point, when my son was diagnosed with autism, I was in prison and talking to the doctor about it. He said, well, you have autism too. I was 48 years old. That was the first time I
Yes.
And, you know, did they ever utilize that as something to deal with during my time?
No. They have no idea what that is.
But he even said I was high autism.
Yeah. There's nothing in the prison system, so we wrote a law, and actually they just started implementing, if you look on, and I'm actually close with the Department of Corrections, the person who's doing that, to implement things to take into account their autism. The other bills, we'll talk real quickly, HB 5043, it's similar to the 988 bill, if you may or may not be familiar with that, is that if you have a mental health crisis, you call and say, I'm having 988, I'm having a mental health crisis, my child is having a fit or something, and they're supposed to send somebody who's trained. Because what has happened before is the police show up, and the son's going all over, they tackle the kid does fight or flight, and there's a very famous case, it was actually just in the Washington Post last week, about Nellie Latson. He was in a library, he was at a library, and he was waiting for the thing to open up, and he had a hoodie, and it was black, and somebody called the police and said, oh, there's this kid with a gun. Police came, what's he do, fight or flight? He's arrested. Goes into the jail, fight or flight with the prisoner or with the guards, another charge. All because he was a young black kid who was waiting to go to the library. Governor McAuliffe gave him a conditional pardon, and Governor Northam finally gave him a pardon, but didn't have a full pardon. That's a whole other issue. The biggest one that we wrote was SB 1315, and this just became law. And we're trying to get this across all of the states. What it says, that if a person is arrested, the second, as soon as they're arrested, and there is an assumption or belief that this person has a developmental disability, such as autism, they are supposed to get that person evaluated and take that into account as it relates to the crime. And with that, I didn't realize when I wrote it, and this was the one I wrote, and I was going to call it Blake's Law. And my son Blake said, don't do that, Dad. So I didn't do that, but it's a very important law because what it does, it takes into account mens rea. Did they have mens rea when they agreed? 99.9% of the answer is no. And the Republicans are pissed because it's tough on crime, because people are starting to use this bill to get these kids out of there. We talked about diversion, we talked about 659. The last one, so I just did this a couple of weeks ago, it was Bill 1303. It did not go through, and I'm gonna figure out a better way to do this. Basically, it says, if your person was charged with autism and had this level of crimes, child porn or something similar to my son's, that after 10 years, you could get it expunged. And in Virginia, the only way you can get off the registry is it has to be expunged. It passed by the Senate. It's interesting, it went to the House, and I actually talked to the House Judicial Committee chair, and he said, no, Brian, I can't support you. And so I knew he was going to kill it, but I brought it out anyway. And luckily, he's not running for re-election next year. So we're going to try this again. One of the things you'll find, and so I'm going to leave you with this. There was a lot here. I have how you do it in my presentation, how I've done it. And again, I am just a parent. And I make all of you parents, I now bless you to go to your delegate and try and do the same thing. If there's an issue, if you know people that have issues, their child with autism gets in trouble, call me. My card's there, or you can just look up LRIDD, LRIDD, and it has a contact, and it has my email. And I talk to every one of them. In fact, there's probably two or three I have to talk to on the way home. So you can be an advocate. You can fight this. We have to change the laws. These children, and they are children on a lot of them, even though they may be older, their sexual development and social development is still here. That line doesn't change unless they're educated. So they're still there, and they should never be on the registry, and a lot of them, people on the registry are autistic. So, questions? I wrap that up in time? I get it. I think so. Yes, ma'am. Okay, good. Yes. And I need to get your podcast because I'd like to put it on our website. So in my slide presentation, it tells you how you do it. I share with you, and you, everyone can call me, and I give out my personal cell number. You can call me, and I will actually talk you through the process as you go and how to do it. How do you do it? First of all, you got to come up with your story, right? And my story was 21 pages. And when I had to present it to the ARC, I had to get it down to 2 pages. When I went to go see the legislator, I had to get it down to 1 page. When I got it down where I had to present to in the committees, I had 3 minutes. And a lot of times they went, sorry, you only have 2 minutes. And a lot of times they went, we got too many, you got 30 seconds. So I've got my 21 pages down to less than 30 seconds. So that's how I did it. So you got to keep it short. You have to get in with your legislator and go to these town halls. That's where you corner them and say, hey, can I talk to you? Don't try and email them. Don't try and call them. They're not going to call you back, and they're not going to email them. You got to corner them. And they have their town halls all the time or whatever. That's the best way. And then you say, can I just, and don't tell them the whole case, right? You only give them the elevator speech, the 30-second. My son got caught up in the criminal justice system, and he has autism. Can I come talk to you? Oh, well, that sounds okay. You don't say the word sex. Never say the word sex. Right? They freak out. Nobody has sex in the legislation. I mean, you laugh, but when I say the word sex, ooh. Even when I said it to the ARC, even when I said it to the Autism Society, they went, ooh, sex. Now they're all starting to come around and go, ooh, sex is an issue. So you find your legislators, get other support groups to go in with you, like the Autism or other parents. What I'm trying to do is get a database of all the parents so I know these are 10 people that live in Illinois, so you 10 people can get together. Go in as a group, have stories, your stories, your stories, your stories, all right? Once you get in, you only have about 5 to 10 minutes, even though they'll give you like 20 or 30 because most of the time they want to talk about themselves. You have about 5, 10 minutes, and just as you have, I saw some of your faces, they will do the same. And I tell women, if you want to cry, that is okay. Especially if it's an old white man. There, little lady. I've seen that with the legislators, especially here in Virginia. Keep it brief, and then when you go in to see them, you always have to, they want to know what you're asked. What do you want me to do? Well, what I want you to do is, this law was passed in Virginia, and it seems to be working pretty well. We want to do the same exact law. And here it is. It's already written for you. All you got to do is cut and paste. So that's what I tell them. And then get a lot of support. Try and get other families, try and get other groups to go in with you to support you so that they know when you're going in, it's not just you. I've got 50 people. And now when I go in, I have other organizations. I have the ARC, I have all these other ones. And we have like 10 groups to come in and say, we support this. So that's how you do it.